Hi there, John Wilkinson and History Made Easier. A video for those of you studying the German depth study, but also I think a video that would be useful in giving context to the German reaction to the Treaty of Versailles, because this video is going to take a look at the German Revolution. The German Revolution wasn't a revolution in the true meaning of the word. The government wasn't forcibly overthrown, though it might have been if either the communists or, after the politicians had taken control, the extreme nationalists had had their way. But it was a period in which Germany went through such a change from an autocratic monarch, even though it had included a parliament, to a democratic republic, that its effects were revolutionary. And there were revolts, starting with a military revolt, and there was fighting on the streets, a lot of fighting with blood spilt and lives lost. Radical change was on the cards when the German High Command, the army's headquarters, informed the Kaiser that Germany was facing defeat, and rather than be defeated, Germany should call for an immediate ceasefire, an armistice. To place themselves in a better position with the Allies, Germany returned to something that at least looked like a parliamentary government. For most of the war, Germany was more like a military dictatorship, headed by Generals Hindenburg and Ludendorff. The Kaiser was persuaded to appoint Prince Maximilian of Baden, the Kaiser's cousin, as his new chancellor. And it was Prince Max who opened negotiations with President Wilson to bring about an armistice on the basis of Wilson's 14 points. However, the Allies insisted on the Kaiser's abdication. And as Germany wavered as to how to respond, at the end of October 1918, German sailors in the Grand Fleet at the naval base at Wilhelmshaven mutinied. They had been ordered to sail and engage the British Navy in what Admiral Scheer saw as a last opportunity for an honourable battle. The seamen, however, saw it differently, a suicide mission. They had a point. Some of the crews refused to obey orders, and on three ships there was outright sabotage and mutiny. On November the 4th, the sailors in Kiel mutinied, and by the evening, the town was under the control of a workers' and soldiers' council. By November the 6th, so was Wilhelmshaven, and workers' and soldiers' councils were established in cities across Germany. For example, Hamburg, Cologne, Frankfurt, Leipzig, Munich, and even Berlin. What came to be known as the German Revolution, which began with the naval mutiny, had rapidly spread with a wave of strikes and military rebellions across Germany. On the whole, it was a nationwide revolt rather than a revolution. But there were revolutionary outbursts. And as I have said, the outcome for Germany was indeed revolutionary, in that it became a republic with a new constitution. With Germany on the point of defeat and order collapsing, the position of the Kaiser was in question. The communists had been openly calling for the Kaiser to abdicate, when on November the 6th, the leader of the Social Democrats, Friedrich Ebert, in order to reinstate a sense of order, reluctantly but publicly called for him to abdicate. Ebert was actually in favour of retaining the monarchy. However, the Kaiser refused. In Munich, meanwhile, a workers' and soldiers' council forced the King of Bavaria to abdicate, Remember, Germany was a federal state, some of which had their own kings or princes, the Kaiser being the emperor over all of this. Anyway, on November the 7th, Kurt Eisner declared a Bavarian Republic. Another Soviet Republic was set up in Saxony. And on November the 8th, Prince Max telephoned the Kaiser, telling him that, and I quote, "Your abdication has become necessary to save Germany from civil war," adding that "the great majority of the people believe you to be responsible for the present situation." The belief is false, but there it is. The next day, Field Marshal von Hindenburg and General Groner, who had taken over Ludendorff's role after he had resigned, went to see the Kaiser to press on him that the army was collapsing, as was order at home, and that indeed it was all over. Hindenburg broke down. Also on November the 8th, Prince Max took it on himself to announce the Kaiser's abdication, and then also resigned, handing the chancellorship to Friedrich Ebert, as he was the leader of the Social Democrats, who were the largest party in the Reichstag that had been elected before the war. Ebert formed a provisional national government. Though a socialist, he was also a Democrat, and he was determined to work with the Reichstag as well as existing local government and the civil service, the law courts, and the police in order to build a lasting peace and rebuild a war-torn Germany on democratic principles. He also wanted the army to continue unchanged, the authority of its officers unchanged. Ebert announced an amnesty for all political prisoners, thus freeing them to join with their different political parties, as well as the agitation on the streets. Amongst those who had been amnestied were Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht. The end of censorship was announced, guaranteed freedom of opinion and freedom of religion, and Ebert set about addressing the most urgent social problems, measures to allay food shortages, promising to address the shortage of housing, promising support for the unemployed, and guaranteeing an 8-hour working day. But at the same time, on November the 9th, Karl Liebknecht had proclaimed a socialist republic, and councils were being elected by workers and soldiers all over the country. Whilst the Kaiser finally accepted his fate, indeed a fait accompli, and on November the 10th went into exile in Holland. So the Kaiser, who had appointed his own ministers, introduced laws, made war and made peace, the man who had referred to the Reichstag as a troop of monkeys, blockheads and sleepwalkers, was gone. And it was the men from the Reichstag who would be obliged to pick up the pieces of his disastrous actions. On the evening of the first day of the new republic, November the 9th, Ebert and General Groner agreed to cooperate so as to ensure order. The army would be loyal to the provisional government and assist it in maintaining order, whilst the government promised it would not reform the army. In particular, it would respect the right of the army to maintain its own chain of command, and with respect to the left, gave the army the freedom to act as it saw fit. Both men wanted to ensure that there would be no Bolshevik revolution in Berlin. Meanwhile, the talks about the armistice terms had finished and the German government announced their acceptance. The war ended on November the 11th. But with armed revolutionary soldiers and sailors in Berlin, the capital resembled a powder keg ready to explode. One group agitating for a second revolution were the Spartacists, a group of communists who formed the Spartacus League. They agitated for a Bolshevik-type revolution that would result in Germany ruled by workers' and soldiers' councils, or Soviets, in every town and rural district, and with no national parliament. Both the police and the army would be disbanded, with local workers' militias taking their place. The workers would take control of large estates of land, mines, factories, and other large companies. And with Germany in chaos, they saw their chance to create a socialist state. And they were led by Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg. On December the 23rd, Red Sailors, encouraged and led by the Spartacists, looted and vandalized the area of Berlin where they were stationed. They surrounded and broke in to the Chancellery building and cut off its telephone links. For a while, Erbert was their captive before he gave in to their demands that they be paid what was owed them, as well as an increase in their pay. However, using the secret line to army headquarters, Erbert had requested urgent military assistance, which was given on Christmas Eve. Though it failed to completely quell the unrest, the soldiers were reluctant to fight fellow military men. The events had polarized politics in Berlin, and the extreme left now thought that they could bring about the collapse of Erbert's government. General Groener responded to what had happened by calling for the Freikorps, volunteer militia units, to police the capital. They had operated already in the Baltic states and were first used by the government to protect the border areas against a possible Red Army threat from the Soviet Union. They were ex-soldiers, extreme nationalists. They held a hatred of the left in general and Bolshevism in particular. They were also against the democratic system set up by the German Revolution. Most wanted the return of the Kaiser. They also sought to undo the humiliation of Germany's defeat. Many even refused to accept Germany's defeat, and if it had been defeated, then it was the fault of the November criminals. Impartial, balanced, respectful of others' opinions, they were not. But they were heavily armed, and they were a disciplined force. So that when the Spartacists initiated an uprising on January the 7th, erecting barricades and setting up checkpoints at key roads and intersections, taking over the offices of a newspaper, as well as telegraph offices, some police stations, government buildings, and the Social Democrats' headquarters. Nosk, who led the Freikorps, instigated a ruthless response. With some 15,000 armed communists and other left-wing groups involved, and up to 40,000 government and Freikorps troops who had machine guns, field artillery, mortars, flamethrowers, and even used aerial strafing and bombardment to quash the rebellion. It must have seemed as if World War I had come to Berlin. It is thought that around 100, maybe 200, were killed. Some estimates put it even more, many more. But the fighting came to an end on January the 15th. Included amongst the dead were the Spartacist leaders, Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg, who were brutally murdered. What is more, thousands more communists were killed across Germany in the aftermath. Ebert remained determined to not only prevent Germany from plummeting into chaos, but to ensure parliamentary democracy. And in all of this, he had organised elections for a constituent assembly, which were held on January the 19th. We're now into 1919. State elections were held at the same time. The constituent or national assembly was to govern Germany and write a new constitution, after which new elections would be held. But Germany was still in chaos. In Berlin, there were more riots and strikes organised by the communists in March, again put down with help from the Freikorps, this time at the cost of over 1,000 lives. Whilst in Bavaria, the People's State, led by Kurt Eisner, had failed miserably. And in the state elections that took place in January 1919, Eisner's Independent Social Democratic Party was resoundingly defeated. Eisner, was then murdered. And in the wake of his assassination, communists again seized control. And on the night of April the 6th, 7th, they made their push for power and set up a second Bavarian Soviet Republic. Lenin telegraphed his best wishes, but Nosk again acted swiftly and ruthlessly. He sent 35,000 men from the Freikorps, well armed and supported by the army. Munich was put under siege until the authorities regained control. There were atrocities on both sides. The Reds killed a dozen innocent hostages. Lenin had suggested that they should take hostages from the bourgeoisie. And Nosk's forces carried out indiscriminate revenge. Officially, 606 lives were lost, though the actual number might have been double that. The leader of the renegade republic was tried for high treason and executed. There would be more trouble from the left as well as from the right in 1920. But the Weimar Constitution was passed on July the 31st, 1919, and ratified on August the 11th. And this heralded the end of the German Revolution. So there you have the German Revolution. An important thing, I think, for you guys to know about. And if nothing else, I think it gives you a clear impression of the utter chaos that Germany was in before the war had even ended and in the immediate aftermath of the war. So as always, I thank you for listening. And as always, I give you a reminder to check out my History Made Easier website. But for now, cheers.